Hallelujah! Hallelujah! God is good all of the time. Put your hands together for the Lord Jesus Christ, everybody. Amen. Thank you. Please have your seats. It's a total blessing to be here. I consider it a miracle for myself. About 16 years ago, my life would have been lost when an AK-47 was pointed right in my chest to be killed because I was considered to be a rebel when I was not one of them. But because God had a plan, I will be here today. That is why I am here. But I'm not alone. I'm here with a team of leaders from Africa. And everything I will attempt to say in the next few minutes I have, it represents our voice. And the voice of your brothers and sisters all across Africa. Yes. So before I do, one of our brothers will just give you a brief statement that expresses our heart and the hearts of your brothers and sisters all across Africa. The Rev. Dr. Jerry.
I have not seen the ladies. It's all men.
There she comes.
There they come. Yeah, but brothers and sisters in the Lord, this gives me a real pleasure to affirm our commitment to what we are doing today. And so on behalf of my brothers and sisters, I'm reading this very short statement of commitment to this very important occasion. We are overwhelmingly grateful to be a part of this history-making event as we gather here today to the birth of the Wesleyan Covenant Association. We come from all over Africa to participate in this very important event because we believe that God has a plan for the Global United Methodist Church.
Yes.
And that God has a redemptive agenda for the nations through the ministries of the United Methodist Church. The agenda is that the world might know who Jesus is, all that he has accomplished for our salvation and redemption, in order that all of humanity might be reconciled to God. Our responsibility in the fulfillment of this agenda is that we might continually proclaim the goodness of Jesus Christ and live faithful and obedient lives consistent with the Word of God. We are so excited, brothers and sisters, to be here because we believe in what God is calling the Wesleyan Covenant Association to accomplish through the ministries of the United Methodist Church globally. We do perceive the WCA as a movement of a new beginnings for the global church. We have come to understand that the WCA is a movement that believes in the Holy Scriptures in its entirety as the authentic Word of God, as we do in Africa. That it is committed to spreading scriptural holiness across the nations, as our founding father, John Wesley, even through the injunction of Jesus Christ, as we do in Africa. We also understand that the WCA is a vision-driven movement committed to the advancement of God's agenda for the evangelization of the nations, the revitalization of the United Methodist Church, and the transformation of our society as we do in Africa. Brothers and sisters, based on the commonalities that we do share, we want to continue to be in partnership with the WCA in achieving the goal for the expansion of God's kingdom until he returns. And with all God's people, we are committed to the mission of making disciples of Jesus Christ for the transformation of the world. In the name of the Father, another Son, another Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
Can arise of us.
Hallelujah. Amen.
Amen.
My dear brothers and sisters, as a demonstration of our faith in God and this great history-making moment, we invite you all to raise your hand to heaven. As a sign of our total surrender to God.
Yes, Lord.
To say, God, have your will in the life of the United Methodist Church.
Yes. Hallelujah.
And to say, God, we have a charge to keep. A God to glorify. A never-dying soul to save and fit for the scar. As we raise our hands to heaven, all of us will burst up in our languages and tribes and just speak to God and present the church to God. Open your mouth now and let's talk to the Lord. Pray. Let's pray together. Let's pray together. Just open your mouth and begin to pray to the Lord and present the church to Him. Father, we worship You. We worship You, Lord. We present the church to You. We commit ourselves to You. And we say thank You. We bless Your name, Lord. We give You the glory. Thank You, Lord. Thank You, Jesus. Let's bring our prayers to a close. Father, as we raise our hands to You, it's a demonstration of our faith in You, our total surrender to You. Lord, we stand here today as a point of contact of the Methodist family around the world. And we say, Lord, take our lives. And let our lives be consecrated unto You and unto Your service. Lead us, O God, to accomplish Your purpose in our generation.
Yes.
Father, we thank You because You will build Your church. And the gates of hell will not stand against it.
Yes,
the gates of hell will not stand against it. We know our struggle is not against principalities and powers, but against spiritual wickedness in high places, against the territorial spirits. And so God will say, thank You, because the weapon of our warfare is not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of every stronghold. We pull down every imagination, every argument, every voice that stands against the voice of God. And we say, Lord, have Your will. Bless us. And make us a blessing. In Jesus' mighty name. In Jesus' mighty name. Thank you. I want to say thanks to the organizing committee. And thanks to everyone who have already spoken before us. And we want to say that we are in total agreement. We are in total agreement with the vision of the Wesleyan Covenant Association. We are in total agreement with you that the Lord, that there is a new day that is being birthed. There's the dawning of a new day. But from our perspective, we see the breaking of revival across the nations. This is the birthing of revival across the nation. But even as we say that, in light of all that is going on around us, in light of what happened at General Conference, what happened at 22 General Conference, and what happened at 2016, and what has happened up to the present, my brothers and sisters, your brothers and sisters in Africa, believe with all your hearts that we are at the crossroads.
Yes. Yes.
The world is at the crossroads. As I was thinking about this, I realized that even the countries in Africa are at the crossroads as they seek to elect national leadership. And the great United States is at the crossroads. Because in a matter of weeks, you will be making decision for a new president. And so you are at the crossroads. And I pray that God will guide you in the process in Jesus' name. So needless to say that the United Methodist Church is at the crossroads and has to decide a path to its future. We are at the crossroads. That is why it is important for us to carefully evaluate the past, understand the present, and anticipate the future that will guide us in the way of truth and righteousness. And that is why I have chosen, by the grace of God, to speak to us this evening on the theme, the UMC at the crossroads, yet moving forward with God's agenda for the nation. Yes, we are at the crossroads, but we are not stagnant at the crossroads. We are moving forward with God's agenda for the nations.
Yes.
You know, the word move, as a verb, it has the idea of change, transition, shift, reposition. And the word forward, as an adjective, it has the idea of acceleration, accelerating. And when you combine the word move and forward, or moving forward, you combine the two as a present progressive phrase, what it suggests, it carries the idea of advancing, making progress, going ahead, forging ahead, and pushing on. The United Methodist Church is not a monument, it's a movement. And we are pushing on. Let us push on for Jesus Christ. It's because of this that we are here. We are here to move on, to push forward. We are at the crossroads, but yet we are moving forward. We are moving forward to fulfill God's purpose in our generation. That our text for consideration is what has been boiling our spirits back in Africa. And it is Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16 describes a time in Israel history where the nation was at a deep spiritual decline. Things are going very bad, as if where Judah was at a crossroads. The prophets, the priests, the political leaders have all abandoned God. Nobody had interest in God and God's word. Everybody was going his own way. They were leading the people in rebellion. And many terrible things were happening. We seem to see the church trekking in the same path today. That is why we want to move forward. Even as we are at the crossroads, we want to continue to move forward. Because at that time in Israel, the word of God had become irrelevant. Idol worship was widespread. And everything was going bad. And today, in our today's world, some people think the Bible has become irrelevant. It is obsolete and it is not desirable to govern the church and to govern the life of God's people. The political leaders and religious leaders at the time have turned their backs on God and driven the people in all kinds of perversions. The word of God had become offensive to the people. Everyone was following his own way. Some were still worshiping in the temple like we do in the church today. But by their attitude and actions, they wanted to have nothing to do with God. They wanted to determine how to live. They wanted to tell God how they should live as far as worshiping God was concerned. Some are getting into all kinds of practices. While national leaders were making bad political decisions, the priests and prophets were giving the people false hope that it would be better. Just follow the cultural system. Just follow the political system of the day. Just follow the current philosophical ideologies. It will all be well. Leading the people astray. My friend, it was in the midst of all of this. A God in his love to reconcile his people, to draw them back to himself, said to them, I will raise up a young man because I have no faith in the priests and prophets. And God raised up young Jeremiah. Of course, Jeremiah rejected the call. But God said, don't say you are small. I will use you, Jeremiah, to reach out to my people. And God spoke to Jeremiah. And eventually, in chapter 6, verse 16, after describing what the situation looks like, God spoke to Jeremiah and told Jeremiah, take this word to my people. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. This is what the Lord says. Stand at the crossroads and look. I saw the ancient path. I saw where the good way is, and walk in it, and you will find rest for your souls. But you say, we will not walk in it. The Almighty God, in pursuit of reconciliation with his people, made this request to Judah. And God said, I want you to do four things. At the crossroads, I want you to stand, to look, to ask, and to walk. My friend, when we reject God, God has a way of calling our attention back to himself. Sometimes he allows crisis to come. Sometimes he allows persecution to come. Or sometimes he will just do something peculiar to call our attention. As our sister was speaking, I was wondering how many persons was on our plane that day who had abandoned God and rejected God. And God used that situation to let them know that he's still the same God.
Yeah.
The crossroads. What is a crossroads, you may ask? The idea of the crossroads is very special for the African. We have to travel sometimes 2 hours to go to the farm. And the kind of farm that we do is subsistence farming, where you have the little hole and you're digging and trying to till the soil to have something. Now they have the mechanized farming that you do around here. We love to do that, but the implements aren't there. So we go in group. So you have a 25 group of people going to one person's farm, will do the job, then the next day they're at the next person's farm. But sometimes when the people will go late, but as they go looking for where the farm is, they will come across a crossroads. And when you come to the crossroads, you don't just jump on one road and begin to move. You stand at the crossroads and you begin to look. And after you look and see many roads and you don't know which one to choose, then you will begin to shout and make a special sound, and that's, I say, where is the road? Where is the direction I need to take in order to join you people? And as you make that sound, somebody on the farm will hear the voice.
Yeah,
and when he hears the voice, then he too will go up on the hill and make a similar sound. And that will give you the right path to walk on and get to your destination.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So when we think about the crossroads, we think that it's a very critical place. The crossroads is a place where you make decisions for God or against God. It's a place where you decide, I will follow the will of God for my life or I will choose my own path. But at the crossroads, we have responsibilities. The first responsibility is to stand. When you get at the crossroads, the first thing you do is to stand. God invites us to stand. To stand means we must be spiritually alert, culturally sensitive, socially adaptable, intellectually informed, and to give careful attention to what God is doing around us, so that we might be a productive part of it. The idea of standing firm brings to mind the soldier who is standing at his guard post. He has to be alert. Even when there is ants going through his nostril, he might just do like this, but he's standing alert. To ensure that the enemy does not just overtake him. So you stand alert. And so the Apostle Paul enjoins us. Stand firm, unmovable, always abounding in the word of the Lord. For as much as you know, your labor in the Lord is not in vain.
Absolutely. Amen.
Moses made the same statement to the children of Israel. When they looked behind them, they saw the Israelites and the Egyptians coming after them. And when they looked ahead of them was the Red Sea. They looked left, they saw the mountain. They looked right, they saw the mountain. And they began to complain. And Moses said to them,
Stand
firm.
The hold of salvation.
And you will see the deliverance of the Lord. For the Egyptians you see today, you will see no more. We need the same encouragement for Methodists who are discouraged back home our people are so much confused, the lay people, the ordinary people. What's happening to the church? What are we hearing? Is it the same people who brought the gospel to us are saying the Bible is irrelevant? Mm-hmm. Is it the same people who sent missionaries here and they died with us in ministry that are no longer following God? They are confused. And they are disturbed and troubled. Is it the same people who said to us, it is a wrong thing for you to have more than one wife and you can serve in the church as a polygamist? Is it the same people who are saying it's good for a man to marry another man? Is it the same people who are saying it's good for a woman to marry another woman? And they are confused. They are at the crossroads. But praise God that God is building his church and the gates of hell will not stand against it.
Yeah.
So we stand again. Stand firm. It is not all over. It looks like that, but it is not true. God's people are everywhere. And today, as we come and see you, we have hope. As we come and see you and hear you, we know there's a better tomorrow. So even though we are at a crossroad, but I keep forging ahead and moving forward God's agenda. And that agenda is proclaiming the undiluted, infallible word of God. That alone is able to say the word of God is sharper than any double-edged sword, piercing even the dividing of soul of soul and spirit, and of the joints and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and intents of the heart. The word of God, for which David said, is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. The word of God that David uses and say, the Lord of the Lord is perfect, converting the soul. The statue of the Lord is trustworthy, making wise the simple. And in verse 11 of Psalm 17, he said, by them is thy servant warned. In keeping them, there is great reward. After we should have stood at the crossroads, the next thing we need to do is to look. My friend, the concept of looking carries the idea of observing, taking account, discerning. And it's the whole idea of vision. Like Bible said, vision is a mental portrait of a better tomorrow. Vision. Have a clear vision for tomorrow. We must have a clear vision for a better tomorrow as to where God is leading the global Wesleyan community called the United Methodist Church. So as we look at the United Methodist Church today, what do we see? Do we see a people who are yearning for the truth or a people who have abandoned the truth for a culture? As we look at the United Methodist Church today, do we see healthy pastors and healthy lay people in our churches? Or we see a group of people who are sick and need a balm from Gilead to save, to heal their sin-sick souls. What do we see? Do we see young people trooping to the church or young people abandoning the church for something else? My friend, based upon whatever you see, the challenge is, amidst the fact that we are at the crossroads, we must move forward with God's agenda for the nation. So we stand, we look, and based upon what we see, we are then eyes to ask. Eyes for the ancient path. Eyes for the good ways. And God will lead us. Eyes and you shall receive. Seek and you shall find. Knock and the door shall be opened unto you. For whoever eyes receives, he who seeks finds. To him who knock, the door is open.
Yes.
I'm reminded of God lead the children of Israel. He did that with a pit of cloud by day and a pit of fire by night. And I believe the same God is available to us today.
Amen.
To lead the United Methodist Church if we will ask him.
Yes.
Amen. And I believe that's why we are here.
Yes.
So that we might be able to ask him. Let us ask the Lord for the ancient path that leads the church to righteousness, that leads the church to peace and joy in the Holy Ghost. Let us ask the Lord for the ancient part that leads the church to genuine repentance and submission to the will of God. And let us pursue that path in such a way that God is glorified.
Amen.
So after we should have stood, look, and ask. The verse says, this is what the Lord says. Stand at the crossroads and look. Ask for the ancient path. Ask where the good way is and walk in it. So after you've stood, you've looked, you've asked, it's time to walk. It's time to walk in the path of righteousness. God invites us to walk in the ancient path. And I submit to you today that that ancient path is the word of God.
Yeah.
Paul says in 2 Timothy 3:16 and 17, all scripture. All, not some. All scripture is given by inspiration of God. And is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. So that a man, and let me add, the woman of God, might be thoroughly equipped for every good work. Amen. That's the word of God. As I conclude my presentation, okay, I'm rushing the time.
I know how it is, preacher.
Okay, as I conclude my presentation, I will ask you myself. If you are going to the Wesleyan Coming Association, you come back and people will ask you a question. So what is your own expectation? And I'm going to be sharing with you my expectation for myself as far as the Wesleyan Coming Association is concerned and the expectation of your brothers and sisters in Africa. As we endeavor to move forward with God's agenda for the nation, in addition to walking with the Lord, in addition to standing and looking and icing and walking, I believe this is the time and season to do a few things. I suggest to them to you, I take my seat. One, it's time to lead.
Yes.
It is time to lead.
Yes.
We must take over leadership and move forward with God's agenda for God's people. I could be misunderstood, but let me make the point very clear. Here is Joshua, who has been anointed to replace Moses, sitting and apparently having his hand between his lap. In Joshua chapter 1, God had to come down and say, look, Joshua, Moses, my servant, is dead. God was saying, Joshua, the chapter is closed. We wait for Moses. Moses will not come. The chapter is closed. It's time for you to lead the people.
Yes.
WCA, it's time to lead. Yes. It's time to lead. And listen to this. The way to lead is to serve faithfully and be a godly example to all. We're not talking about title and position. We're not talking about some reputation or the no. The way to lead is to serve and be a godly example.
Amen.
So that you can produce a church that is biblically committed, Christ-centered, Holy Spirit-empowered, evangelistically functional, mission-minded, credible, accountable, vision-driven, and accomplishing God's purpose in this generation. Secondly, be courageous. And so God said to Joshua, be courageous. And Joshua had to learn a lesson because very soon he will be disappointed by trusted friends, such as Achan. So we need to be courageous as we move forward. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war with the cross of Jesus before us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising its shame, and is sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. Dependence upon God. We must totally depend upon God to take us to the next level. Not our human philosophy, and that is not all the threatening situation around. No! God, depending upon God. And he will lead us in the way of truth and righteousness. And of course, I talk about having a clear vision. And I love what Bill Haber says. He said, vision is the most potent weapon for world change. It is the fuel that leads us run on, the energy that creates action, the fire that ignites passion of followers, and it is a clear call that sustains the focused effort year after year, decade after decade, as people offer consistent and sacrificial service to God. We must produce Christ-centered leadership across all of our jurisdictions, across all of our annual conferences. To move forward, we must develop Christ-centered leaders, biblically-minded leaders, all across our jurisdiction. And we must rely upon God's resources. My friend, I wish to remind all of us that the only sustainable path to global unity of the people called United Methodists is total submission and loyalty to the Lord Jesus Christ in an exclusive obedience to the Word of God as primary authority for faith and Christian living. While we live within a diverse culture and religious worldview, it is important that we love and embrace everyone, but we must continually live within God's perimeter of grace defined by the scripture. Furthermore, we must endeavor to develop a Christ-centered, mission-minded, and evangelical, functional, and Holy Spirit-empowered leadership across our annual conferences, districts, and local churches who commit to live a life worthy of God's praise. And when we do this, very soon we'll be off the crossroads and we'll keep marching and moving forward and accomplishing God's purpose for this generation until God comes. May that be so for us in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.